Hey folks, David Frost, my strategic forecast. You're here for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis. This market review is for Friday, February 9, 2018. You're looking at a daily chart of the SPY or Spider, which is the proxy for the S&P 500. And it was another wild day out in the markets today. As you can see on the Spider chart, and this is the proxy for the S&P 500, the bottom upsloping trend line, the black trend line, represents the 200 period moving average. As you can see, the Spider or the S&P came down today to touch and pierce through slightly the 200 period moving average, at which time the market found support and rocketed back higher. All week long, we've been discussing the fact, and specifically on Thursday, we were talking about the importance of the weekly close. And the importance of the weekly close was going to be if the market, in fact, closed below, for example, Thursday's low, which is the red candle here, if the market closed below that low, that would have been a very negative sign. However, even though the market was very weak for the majority of the day on Friday, in the afternoon session, the market did rally back to close above that low from Thursday and actually, on volume, put in a pretty good tail candle. A tail candle, more often than not, is a signal of at least a short-term trend change. Now, even though we've had very, very wild and wide-ranging markets, the market's been very whippy, we've had huge intraday swings, but I want to point out a couple of things that really accentuates or proves the point that the market is still trading according to the technical attributes that we outline here in these videos each and every day. First off, the first piece of evidence is the 200 period moving average. The market respected the 200 period moving average, ended up rallying off that level. That goes to show you, at least on the first hit, and today was the first hit of the 200 period moving average in quite some time, but the market respected that level and found support at that level. After the market rallied off that level, look where we went to. We went to touch the underside, or from the underside, of the 100 period moving average. This is the purple trend line, and you can see here that intraday, we touched the upsloping purple trend line, which is the 100 period moving average, and then backed off that level. The market was somewhat rejected from that level. That shows you that the 100 period moving average, since we broke below it, is now acting, at least temporarily, at least from Friday, as a resistance point. We take it down to an hourly chart and look for more evidence that the market is trading technically sound. And you can see here on the hourly chart, the red sloping trend line is the 20 period moving average. That's home base, right? We like to call the 20 period moving average home base. We came up to the 20 period moving average on the hourly chart and backed off that level. That goes to show you the importance of the 20 period moving average coming back up from the underside of it. The other piece of evidence, at least albeit from a short-term perspective, was the $260.25 level. Once we broke that level, first we had support at that level, but on the second go-around, when we came back down to that level from on top of it, the first hit is a good hit, and then we rallied up, and when we came back down to that level, it's not as important as it once was on the first hit. We broke through that level, pierced through it by quite a bit, came below it. When we came back up to that level for the first time, you can see in this candle, we hit that level, pierced through it by a little bit, and backed off from the 260 and a quarter level. That again shows you that level was important to the market, and at least from a temporary perspective, the market respected, or this chart respected, that number. Same numbers, same stuff. Looking at a 10-minute chart, you can see that 260 and a quarter. When we rallied from the underside back up to that level, it did act as resistance. We backed off of it, and then we built some energy. It's kind of like the market took a deep breath to try and get through it. We consolidated for a while. This is something else that's taught in my course. These consolidation patterns, very clear and decisive. The market built some energy to get through that level, did get through that level, and even on the 100 period moving average, on the 10-minute chart, found resistance at that level. So even as wild and crazy as the markets were, the markets are trading technically sound. Now we're back on the daily chart, and the big question is, what happens from here? Do we rally up further? Was that the bottom? Do we make new highs? All those questions are going to flood the media on Monday, and let's try and decipher where we are and what our expectations should be. The first thing we notice is we had pretty good volume, 283 million shares on a tail candle. That's good volume. That is not necessarily capitulation volume, since we did have already 350 million shares. So it wasn't the highest volume day of recent, but it is good volume. Is it a bottom? It's really too early to tell if it's a bottom. However, I do believe at the very least it's a short-term bottom. We have options expiration week coming up. So next Friday is options expiration on the monthly options. And generally speaking, during the month of options, or pardon me, the week of options expiration week, the market does get somewhat whippy. We will see some back and forth behavior. We will see up days and we will see down days. Now here's one thing to look out for. Under normal conditions, the majority of the time, not every time, but a lot of the time, we're eventually going to get, if this is a bottom, we're going to get a retrace of this tail candle. If we were to get a retrace on Monday or Tuesday of this tail candle, then we would get a retrace of about 50%, could be more, could be less, but roughly speaking, about 50% of the way down that tail candle. Now, if that holds and the market goes higher, that's going to be good for a low for at least a few days at a bare minimum. If we close below the low of Friday's candle, if we close below Friday's low, that's going to be negative for the market, and that's going to tell us that there's a lot more downside coming to this market. But we have to think logically about what happened. We're leading into options expiration week. There's been a lot of puts purchased specifically by retail traders during this particular week, last week. Now, with a lot of the puts purchased, the job of the options desks at the large banking institutions, hedge funds, investment banks, and others, their job is to make money during the monthly options expiration week, which is this coming week. So you have to believe that they're going to rip the market up, and they've already begun that process in order to make the options that were bought, the puts that were bought, expire worthless. So the majority of the move up today or Friday was, at least after the initial bottom was made at the 200 period moving average, was a lot of short covering, and then buying begets buying. When investors or traders see buying and they're short the market, they're forced to cover. Their emotions force them to cover their positions because they don't want to take any more loss than they already see happening or developing at that given time. It's basically panic buying. It's forced buying in the market. Now, on the daily chart, the line in the sand is going to be the high of the candle, the high of this particular red candle from Thursday's market activity. That high comes in just over 268 at $268.17. That's a far cry from where we closed on Friday. So what we want to do is get a little more granular and go back to an hourly chart and see what else we can find about where the resistance and where the market may find additional buyers getting above certain levels. And the first thing I have to notice is the 20 period moving average. So if we closed an hour above the, or at least an hour, but likely 2 hours above the 20 period moving average, that's going to be a positive sign. There's a consolidation area here, and if we're able to get above this area and above the 20 period moving average on a closing hourly chart closing basis, that's going to be positive for the market. Then we just stair step our way higher. Here's your next level of resistance. Here's your next level of resistance up from there. Then you're going to have the 50 period moving average. You're going to have another resistance point. You're going to have this top here, and you have moving averages up. So it's just one step at a time, 1 hour at a time. Can the market close above these levels in a stair-step fashion, or do we just rocket higher Monday? It's possible, not necessarily probable, but certainly a possibility. I doubt the market's completely out of the woods yet, but certainly Friday's action could have been at minimum of a bottom that lasts for a week or two, or it could be a longer term bottom. We just don't know yet. Our job is not to project exactly what's going to happen over the next week, two or three. We take it one day at a time, and we analyze the charts based on the activity that just happened, and we use the probabilities to determine what the next highest probability is. Right now, the probabilities are this is at least a short-term bottom. We know that the probabilities are if we close any day below Friday's low, that's certainly negative for the market. Right now, this is a tail candle. Any retrace of this tail candle can be bought. However, any close below the low from Friday, you have to move out because the market's going to come lower. If the market begins to float up on Monday and things look positive and the sentiment is positive out in the market and in the media and the market looks like it's going to want to go higher, obviously, as we discussed, this is your first level of defense for the market. If we can get through that red candle high, the next area of great importance is right above the $270 mark, which isn't that far away from that red candle high. That's going to represent a 50% retracement using the pivot top and the low from Friday. A 50% retracement of that move is likely if we continue higher early this coming week. That's also going to provide a pretty good level of resistance to the market. The other thing I want to point out, just from a larger term perspective, is when we look at the weekly chart, I see a couple of things that are important to me. Number one is we never came down to the 50-week moving average. We came close, but we didn't hit it. So to me, that's somewhat of what I like to call an unresolved position. The fact that we came close to the 50-week moving average tells me that the market really needed to at least touch the 50-week moving average. And you know what I always say, markets like to come back and retest former breakout and former breakdown areas. This area right here is a former breakout area. It's below the 50 period moving average. We had identified the 246.31 level, give or take, as an area where the market would likely want to get to. You had a pretty good sized consolidation area here before the last breakout. That was the melt up that we just ran since last summer. And we'd never really came back down to test that area. I still think the market needs to do that. That's one of the things on the longer term chart that has me thinking that we're not completely out of the woods just yet. We may have a rally for a few days, even a couple of weeks, but I'm not 100% sure that that's all there is on the downside. You'll hear the media say that the market went down 10%. That's a correction. Now we can reset and go up from there. And that's fine. That's one way to look at things. The way I look at it is there's an unresolved position or an unresolved number in my mind in the 50-week moving average. That's number one. The second thing is, even though we did have a 10% correction, it was very fast. We came down for 2 weeks. We really didn't give the market participants enough time to really get scared. And that leaves some form of the correction unresolved for me. We have to really scare the pants off investors, mutual fund managers, the pundits on TV. There really hasn't been enough fear populating through the market, in my opinion. The correction was very fast, and I don't think people had a real chance to let it sink in on how much money was sucked out of the market in a 2 week period of time. So we'll see if that has any meaning, but for the correction, a 10% correction to only last 2 weeks, that's just not enough time for me. And you know that I've always said that time is more important than price in the markets. And I think a correction has to last a little bit longer. In fact, a lot longer than just 2 week period of time. So the question is, do we go sideways to higher for a couple of weeks and then have another leg down? That's really what I'm favoring at this point. It's a little bit too early to make that a specific forecast, but that is really in the forefront of my mind. I don't think this correction, if that's what you want to call it, had enough time under its belt. Doesn't mean we can't go higher for a few days or even a couple of weeks, but I don't think it's over because I think time is not on our side in terms of this correction. Looking over at the IWM, as you know, my favorite market leading indicator on both the up and the downside, you know, we were significantly lower in relation to the S&P 500. We had already been to the 200 period moving average, and this was really technically the third hit of the 200 period moving average on Friday. We pierced through it by quite a bit and put in a very similar type candle, a long tail with a doji on the Russell 2000 or the IWM index. So, but it looks the same. It looks very similar, the same market activity, the same type of volume in relation to the volume from the other day. We had 53 million shares in the IWM against that high day of over 65 million shares. So everything was, relatively speaking, very similar to the S&P 500. When we look at the transports, my second favorite market leading indicator on the up and the downside, interestingly enough, the transports made an attempt at its 200 period moving average. However, it came up short. And this is really the same concept that I just discussed with the weekly chart in the SPY or the S&P 500. It came up short. In my mind, it's an unresolved position. How does a market come up short coming that close to the 200 period moving average without actually hitting it? Of course, it happens. It's possible. It just doesn't happen that often. It was just too easy to hit it. And that just leaves some unresolved business in my mind. Same big long tail candle. The Dow Jones Transportations were very, very oversold, getting far, far away from home base or the 20 period moving average. And we had a nice snapback that took in or developed a nice big long tail candle, very similar to the other markets. Moving on to the gold market, gold had some weakness. We seem to be putting in a bearish pattern. Although there is a tail candle here that almost hit the 50 period moving average, we're still consolidating in this lower end of the range. If we build another couple of days worth of consolidation down here, that's going to be the market's way of indicating to us that it's building energy for another leg lower. We said all along that this area is going to act as support for the market. Right now, we have been and are finding support in this general zone. If the market's going to rally, it's going to have to do it relatively quickly. The more consolidation that happens down in this lower range, the more likely we are to have another leg lower. And the fact that we're consolidating over the 50 and close enough to the 100 period moving average tells me that the longer we would consolidate sideways, if that happens, the less importance these two moving average actually have, because the market would be building energy the longer it would consolidate above these moving averages to go lower. If the market does turn around, meaning the gold market, we're going to find some resistance first at the 1333 level and then 1338. I don't think the importance of those two numbers has left the market just yet. They're important. And you can see here, even the 20 period moving average curling back around comes in right at the 1338 level. So even if we were going to have a couple of up days in the gold market, you can see that most likely the 20 period moving average would put a cap on the upside, at least temporarily for the time being. Right now, we just haven't consolidated enough time in order to say the market's building energy or has built enough energy to go lower. It can certainly go lower from here. But if we consolidate for another 3 or 4 days here, then I would say the odds are significantly increasing for another down leg in the gold market. We need a few more days of activity to decipher gold, and we'll keep talking about it as time goes. The next market we'll look at is crude oil. And I think it was either on Thursday or maybe even Wednesday, I discussed the fact that 58.25, if reached, was a lay down trade. And you see what happened. We got to that level intraday. And here's the 10-minute chart, the intraday chart. We hit that level. We pierced through it by a little bit, making a low of $58.07. So not far off the 58 and a quarter we discussed. And we had an immediate rocket ship higher. And just in a matter of about 40 minutes worth of trading, for example, we were at a high of $59.72. In terms of oil and commodities, anybody that was even long one contract from the 58 and a quarter level made a ton of money off that level in a very, very short period of time. Why was that level important to the market? We're back on the daily chart. The level was extremely important to the market because, as I always say, and I've said it already in this video, it was a former breakout and breakdown area. This level was first resistance to the market. Resistance up here, resistance here. We couldn't get through it. Once we got through it, that's classified as consolidation and a former breakout area. The market came back to test a former breakout area. It did its test and it had a nice bounce off that level. Will we sustain above that level? We'll see what happens on Monday and beyond. But at least on the first hit of a level like that, and your first hit is always your best hit. That's your best trade. Whether you're trading intraday on a very short-term basis or you're swing trading off a daily chart, your first hit of a level is your best hit of a level. Second, third, and beyond, not so much. The more opportunity the market has to beat on a certain level, the more opportunity that level has to break, the less important that level becomes or the less strong that level becomes. Think of it as you're banging down a door. You're banging on the door, banging on the door. The more times you bang on a door, the more you weaken that door. Eventually, if you bang on it enough, you're going to be able to knock the door down. But if you walk up to a door for the first time and hit it with your hand, it's unlikely you're going to break through that door. Therefore, you're really going to bounce right back off. And that's the same concept. Your first hit is your best hit for a reaction in the other direction. Before we wrap this video, I thought we'd take a look at a couple of market-leading stocks. The first one we'll take a look at is Apple. You can see where Apple came on Friday, right to about the $150 level. Didn't quite get there. I was ready to buy the $150 level. I didn't get a chance. I was waiting for it and it never happened. The low was 150 spot 24, $150.24. And the market took a huge rally off that level, closing the day at 156.41. We were very oversold, overextended. And when the market got its bounce off its levels, everything got a lift. It's the rising tide lifts all boats syndrome. And Apple had a lift around from the $150 level. The other reason why that's important is 150 is what I like to call a big fat round number. 100 is a big fat round number. 200 is a big fat round number. But also the halfway points. 150 is a big fat round number. Markets like those big round numbers. And they also like numbers like 140, 160, 170. Those are important, but the rounder the number, the more important the number. So 150 is more important than 160. 100 is more important than 150. And when you're talking about a lower price stock, 50 is more important than 40, but 40 is important. 25 is more important than 27, but 27 is still important because it's a round number. But 25 is, you know, think of it as a dollar is split into four quarters. So there's an importance to 25. There's an importance to the halfway point of 50. There's an importance to 75, three quarters of a dollar. So markets work very similar to everything, the way things work in our lives. Certain things have more important than more importance than others, and those things populate through the markets just as they populate through our lives. We'll take a look at Amazon also, and there's a reason why I want to look at Amazon. First, you see how stretched it was intraday. Didn't hit the 50-period moving average. Again, I look at that as an unresolved position. Why not hit the 50-period moving average on the daily chart when coming so close? I think it will. I think it should. It may take a few days. It may take a couple of weeks. But I just get the sense that we're not finished in total with this sell-off in the market. But there's something else I want to point out. The Amazon chart that's very important. So look at the weekly chart. Now, we put in what I like to call a pseudo doji candle, not this week, but the prior week. That's important, and now we had a follow-through week on the downside. We didn't break this, We didn't break this low from the prior week, the week ending 126.18. We broke it intra-week, but we didn't close below it. That's important. Maybe we go sideways, and maybe we go back up. But maybe, just maybe, this pseudo doji candle has some more meaning, and this is one of the things that I discuss in my course at Lazy E Mini Trader. There is some meaning to that, so until and unless we can close a week above the all-time high in Amazon, then the pressure should be to the downside in this stock. Now keep in mind, we're looking at a weekly chart, so these things take time to play out. It's not day by day, it's week by week, so each one of these candles is a week. So when you look at the longer term picture, it takes several weeks for these type of patterns and trend change signals to play out. But I thought I would point that out. I think it's interesting. Switching over to a chart of JP Morgan Chase. Why do I look at JP Morgan Chase? It's the largest banking institution in the country. Therefore, A, it's owned by all the hedge funds, all the mutual funds, any financial related index has JP Morgan within it. So it's important to the markets. And what I see in JP Morgan is a chart that looks very similar to the spider chart, and that's a rising tide lifts all boats. I would expect the charts to look somewhat similar. But what I see here is I see a potential bearish pattern developing on JP Morgan. So until and unless we can really close above Thursday's candle high or really even the 20 period moving average, the pressure really, while we may go higher to challenge that area, this is a bearish pattern. And until this is cleared on the upside, then the pressure is really to the downside. So I don't think JP Morgan's out of the woods quite yet, but we may see continued buying from an oversold condition into this coming week during the week of options expiration. And with that, folks, I think this video is getting a little bit long in the tooth, so I'm going to give it a wrap. It's everything I wanted to and intended to discuss. So we'll wrap it here. I'm David Frost, My Strategic Forecast. Thanks for tuning in for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis.